What is RAG? The dry definition is like combines LLMs with retrieval system for enhanced accuracy and relevance. And the key benefit is it provides up-to-date specific information beyond static training data. This is very dry, so I will try to do this with an analogy instead, so that we understand what we are dealing with here. So imagine that there is a woman called Jenny, and she's very bright. You see that on top of her head. She's very bright. And you happen to meet Jenny when you, I don't know, walk your dog. So you meet Jenny, and you immediately see that she's very bright. Whatever you are talking about, like accounting or invoicing or finances or math or history, she has a hunch. She knows a little bit on everything and general, very good common knowledge. But then you are thinking, okay, she's a smart woman, and we need a new colleague to my work. So what is needed for Jenny to become part of the team at work? Even if Jenny is very smart, it doesn't really help her to just sit down and start doing the work, right? And that's why when we are onboarding, the new fancy word we're using today, anyways, you know what I mean. When we are onboarding someone into our work, we are taking them on mentoring. We are maybe sending Jenny to attend a course on some software that we are using, or maybe we have internal courses to show how we are doing some stuff. And also we give her access to the documentation we have. It might be, you know, Confluence or SharePoint, whatever it is. We have some kind of a base with documents. And we want Jenny to have this if we are starting to onboard her. And then after a while, Jenny will be part of the team, and Jenny will be able to do the things we are doing. So you see that just her smarts and being brilliant doesn't help her. She needs to have some extra info to be super useful in a setting. And basically what we are saying here is that it's the same with AI, right? With the generators, LLMs that we have today, that they themselves contain lots of information and stuff. But if we are not able to give them the extra info, their specific help in our situation might not be optimal. Let's say that you have a company that is doing, I don't know, heat pumps, right? If you start to talk with ChatGPT about heat pumps, probably it knows quite a lot, can tell you how they work and so on. But if you are working in company X, and company X is doing the models M1, M2, and M3 of heat pumps, when you start to talk about, with ChatGPT about M2, it won't know any specifics, probably. So it would be really nice if we could do like with Jenny, that we could make accessible to, you know, the LLM, extra information so that it can actually help us more specifically with the things that we are doing. I actually added this guy because we are hearing so much today about these people will be without the job, and these people and developers will be without the job, and so on. And I'm actually seeing another trend now when I'm talking to some people out on the market and seeing what people or decision makers want. Decision makers, they fear that everyone else will have this before they will have it. So now lots of decision makers are looking for who can help us. Who can help us to integrate so that we can get AI into our existing systems or maybe something new we will build. Think, for instance, about the things like filling out forms and such in a system. And when you fill out forms, both you can have help from AI. If AI is inspecting what is happening, like 100 fill outs, probably it can have some good insight on what should happen on the 101st time, right? The same things if you just put it as a controller afterwards to check the info. It will probably tell you that, look, I have seen that you have put, when this customer was here, then this checkbox was always checked before, but like many times. Why haven't you done it this time? So a controller function. We will see so much of this, I think, in the future. So that's why I put the guy there, and we will have lots of integrations. And we are actually starting to learn today how to do the basics that is needed for an integration, we could say. RAG advantages, and of course, on top of a normal LLM. We have dynamic access to updated information as compared to the normal models that are, as you know, static and locked in time. They are making new models, but then they are also locked in time. improved accuracy and relevance. So that we said about, you know, the heat pump in this example, right? That, you know, we want to discuss this exact model, not, you know, general knowledge about the area. And also better handling of niche topics. It's a little bit about this improved accuracy. It's about talking about these specific things. We'll get to that. So when we don't have RAG, it looks like this. This is what probably everyone here is using probably daily, right? Is there anyone that is not daily using ChatGPT or some other generator? No one, okay. Oh, there is one. Cool. So now you will build a RAG. That's cool. Anyways, so the normal thing is that you are just asking a question and you get some answers back based on all that knowledge that is built in. The only reason why I'm showing you this very simple picture is for you to see how we are building the argumentation on top. So RAG is retrieval augmented generation. So what we are doing here is that we are breaking the normal loop where the user would just ask something and get some answers back. What we will be doing now instead is, once this question is asked here, you see when I'm doing this, right? That's cool, yeah. So when the question is doing this, the user is doing this, instead of going directly to the LLM, we're actually going to some kind of storage here. And there we are pulling up something that is relevant in form of, let's say that you could have, you know, if you had a book on some subject and you have some skilled person that could just copy-paste the relevant parts and submit together with your question and say, please answer this question based on the pastes from that person. Probably the LLM would be in a much better position to do a much more precise and good answer. So that's exactly what we will be doing. And we will be looking at this guy over here as well, right now, to see how we can achieve this functionality without having a person that needs to select this manually. So welcome, vector indexes. We will be dealing with a framework that is called Llama Index TS today. Has anyone heard about it before? Hands up. Llama Index. Llama Index. Yes, good. So there are several. Now, Llama Index TS is the TypeScript version. And as I said, that's what we are choosing here this time. Okay, let's see what's happening when we are starting something called the generation, generating the index. Here we have the equivalent of what we usually would have in SharePoint or Confluence or some other document store. And we are putting it into the index and we are starting the generation. And what happens over here then is that, imagine that you take all those documents and printouts and you cut them up in small pieces, like, you know, like maybe 1/4 of a page or something, lots of small pieces. And then you put tags on them so that they are somehow grouped to whatever subject they are working on. Are you with me here? I'm trying to see. Okay, yeah, you're with me. Great. So this is the generation phase. We're taking a stack of documents, we are putting it in there, and it's cutting it up and putting somewhere here in this index. So this piece of this information will have kind of a vector here somewhere. And what's the purpose? Once we are ready with the generation, we have these small pieces. So all the information from the original documents is in that index, but it's spread over and kind of categorized by flavor or whatever you would like call it. It's based on the grammatics and the words and sentences, phrases inside those pieces. And the magic thing happens, or magic, the good thing happens. Hi. The good thing happens when you make a query towards the same index, because the query then will happen to have a vector that is usually very close to snippets that have to do with the things you want answers for. So when you make this question and you have some phrases and words and things, this query usually has a vector that is, you just select the pieces and snippets that are close to it, as possible. And the way we do it in RAG is we choose a number of such snippets. I'm also dropping the phrase score here, because the score that we will be looking at when we are starting to do the practical part is how close the query is to whatever snippet we found. The snippets inside Llama Index are all, actually called nodes. So you can put that, you know, somewhere back in your brain as well, because you will hear that interchangeably. So what are the weaknesses? I will try to keep it simple, so I will go for data quality problems today. And I think it's perfectly fine, because this is also what you need to do this the first time, and also see what might be wrong if you get strange answers the first time you're trying this. So inaccuracy. Of course, right? If you put in lies there, then it will answer lies. It's obvious. Then we have redundancy. Maybe in the company, three people have written about the same procedure in three different ways. It would probably find them all and try to mix them. The redundancy, we are trying to avoid that. Irrelevance. In the company store, somehow the boss's all shopping list ended up in the store. Doesn't really help. Outdated information, that's obvious. Inconsistency, that you know what it is. That is, if it says that pump M2 has capacity of 500 liters in one document and 5,000 liters in another, right? But then noise, that's an interesting thing. Noise is documents that kind of have lots of keywords in them but don't have real substance or contents. A very good example is if you scan the old kind of book, you know, so in the beginning of the book, usually you have the chapter names and you have the page numbers, basically, but you don't have any substance. So usually this index will have a very high score rank while not giving anything, not giving any help to generating a serious answer. So this is a good example of noise. So, one thing that I will tell you about before we are going into now the practical part where we will be trying to build the RAG is that, as we said, this is a very, very fresh thing, right? Calling yourself an expert in RAG is almost absurd unless you're working at Llama Index or something like that. So I think that we should be humble here. And lots of people have great ideas. So I'm just going to tell you about it, because once you get your RAG running, it's very possible that you will see that there is room for improvement and you will start try other things to have it work even better. So one thing that I can tell you about, like an alternative flow, is sometimes the user is not making an optimal question. So some people have, for instance, invented an alternate flow where they are taking the question, sending it off to the LLM first and say, I want you to give me one very specific and very well-phrased version of this question, and I want you also to give me a very generic version of this question. So you have kind of two versions. And then they send them off into kind of parallel flows into two RAGs. So they send it off to the document store, the generic question, to pick up all the documents that are interesting for that question. And then they send off the other one, the specific question, do the same. Send it off to LLMs. This is going in parallel, right? So these are different flows. And once those two flows are ready, then they are asking a parallel in a third kind of flow to merge this information, to try to build as a good answer for this question as possible. I hope it was somehow understandable. I know that it's a little bit hard to get, but the point is here that I'm not trying to say that you should do this. I'm just saying that lots of people are trying lots of different versions here, that you can send it off to LLM for some pre-processing here or there or somewhere. So yes, so this is kind of extended flows, and I think that we will see in the future frameworks that will pop up in the later on, we will probably get lots of those known flows that this framework handles well or something like that as well. This is probably the future. So let's talk a little bit about the RAG that we will be building today. I want you to, if you want to have fun, of course, you can choose to have not fun, but to pick up this URL on your phone, because this is the manual of a Ford Model T 1919 model. And the reason that I want you to do that, because we are going to build a rag on this manual. So if you have this manual, you can actually, later on, if we have some time, you can ask me to put some question to this rag based on if you find something interesting in this manual. We'll be using Llama Index TS, as I said, GPT 3.5 Turbo. We are using this through the API, of course. We are going to do our own knowledge base. So the demo that we will start this off, this is called the chat based on Llama Index. We will start to tweak that chat from scratch so that we are using our data. It's always fun to use your own data rather than something someone else put in, right? We will then improve the prompt. You will see why. I will try to demonstrate why the original prompt is very stupid. So this is a thing that it takes very little energy, but improves the answers very much. Then we will add something that is not in the demo, in this their demonstration. It's able to see the queries and the nodes as we are working with it. So I tweaked this a little bit, and I will make this available on GitHub afterwards, so I will link it under the YouTube video, so that when you want to do it, you can just copy-paste it from YouTube, from GitHub, basically. And the last thing is just a simple thing. It's just prompt injection vulnerability. We have to remember that LLMs are extremely vulnerable for prompt injection. When it comes to the normal database injections that we are doing, it's quite easy because it's only a matter of, you know, semantics to secure them. But it's not that easy when it comes to our new friends, the LLMs. So, building a rag in TypeScript. Now we'll see if we are able to do this. It's always fun with live demos, and it's double the fun when you are doing a live demo with something as random as LLMs. So yeah, let's see. So because it's so hard to not forget to do something important, I have actually written myself a list that we will be following for the demo or this installation. So basically, let's see here. Basically, if we go to the homepage of Llama Index TS, it looks like this. So this is, of course, where you will also probably start if you want to do something similar that we are doing. And the demo that we are starting out with, that we will be tweaking, is starter tutorials and the chatbot tutorial. So we will be starting with this command over here. So let's see here. Okay, so I'm going to open a terminal, write that. I'm going to go to a suitable folder. And prepare some stuff. Okay, so I'm going to follow my manuscript. First of all, it's like this. I don't want to share my OpenAPI key with you. So I'm going to do something that you don't really have to do when you are trying this at home, because you will be able to enter your OpenAPI key directly as part of the installation you will see soon. But I'm just going to do this because I want to hide it. So I'm doing this, and then I'm going to do the... this is copied from the homepage. So I'm doing exactly that the homepage demo for chat is doing. What is your project named? Let's possibly name it the same as it was before. That's okay. And I'm going to go for basically the defaults. I'm going for chat. I'm choosing Next.js because then we get a nice chat interface into the browser. Then no telemetry. Here you have the OpenAPI key. Here I'm not entering anything, but you can do that, and then it will be even easier when you do it. And then I'm just going for defaults. Okay, this one is a little bit interesting. So here is the vector database. We are going for the easiest way that I think is just JSON files in the file system. And that's okay when we have a small database and we don't have to do much. Of course, when we are starting to experiment and doing, you know, over a huge amount of documents, we probably want to have a more serious store. So then we can go, do you see something or is it too small maybe? Maybe I can do it a little bit larger. Ah, okay, now it went away, so. Okay, now we have the last question, and it's what do you want to do? So I'm gonna generate code and install all the dependencies. So it will start and it will take plus minus 2 minutes or something to do this. So while we're doing this, you can scroll on your phone and find some funny question to ask about T-forts. And it's actually cool because when I read the manual the other day, because I needed some material to show on the rag, I was impressed because, do you know how it is with starter motors on the T-fort from 1919? Normally you had this crank, right? This was the normal way, but you had as an extra, you could buy to your car, the starter motor that you just press a button and it starts. That's quite cool. By the way, the manual for Ford is from Project Gutenberg, or however you pronounce it. This is the project of kind of free books that where the copyright has expired or it's public domain or something. Now we have installed all the dependencies, so we are up and ready to go. So let's see what we will do next. I will do it like this. I will actually open up in my IDE this project because we will be doing some changes to it, and it's easier that way. I think we'll open that one. So we have a nice README in this project that is, of course, from them. And it says what we can do. NPM install is already done when we chose this option. But then we will have to do the NPM run generate. This is for taking the document we want to generate, right? Because there is some kind of document lying there already, but we will replace it. I will show you. And then after that, we can do the NPM run dev to run the project. So starting here, we will see here under data, you see that there already is some kind of a PDF. This is from the original project that they generated. They have put some PDF from the US postal system or something like that as their example. We don't like that, so we take that one and we choose, or we press delete, like that. And then we're gonna take the Ford manual from the desktop. I have prepared it like that, and we will paste it into data, like that. And now we have the Ford manual instead of whatever data that they had there. It should be said that, you remember that I talked with you, I already told you about this, that we should maybe clean the data a bit or improve the quality. So I have left the index here, but I have removed all the Project Gutenberg headers, footers. I have removed some other indexes of words in the end just to remove, you know, the noise. So I have done a little bit with this thing, but I will upload this to GitHub as it is, so you can look at it if you want to. But this is the Ford manual. You might also see that in your phone when you're looking at it, you are seeing the version that is with pictures and stuff, but I have chosen the pure text version for simplicity. Okay, so now we have prepared the data, and now we will generate on top of that, right? We will generate the vector index. So we are doing this, we are going into the correct folder, and then we are doing npm run generate, like that. And take a look now in, let's see here what happens. Oh, I already know what, I forgot to put in my API key because I removed it before. Okay. Like that, and now we can run it again. So it actually tells you here on screen and the files that are generated. There will be three files in a folder that is now called cache in the project. There was no cache folder before, but now we have it. So now, after we have done this, and we go back here, you see that it took like 6.3 seconds to do this, and we actually like tokenized it. So it actually eats some tokens on the API to do this. But then you end up with this store here. It's a very, very little cost when we are talking these small things. But I, just for interest, I also tried to do the Steve Jobs book, if you know the Steve Jobs book, his memoirs or whatever it is. And it's a very, very thick book. And boom, and it had eaten like $6 or $7 on the API. But I was using, I think, GPT-4 as well, so yeah. But I'm just saying, if you put something very large in there, it would actually eat quite a lot of usage as well. Yep, so now we have generated, and now we should be able to just do npm run dev to get up the rag in its first form. And this is basically, you could say, except we just changed the data now. This is what you get out of the box when you run this command, this install, the install script that they have provided from Llama index TS. It's up and running. Let's see if we can connect to that server on localhost 3000. And it can be a bit slow the first time around. Yeah. So we're up and running. And so we can already now try our first question regarding Ford's Model T here. We can already start. So I will actually start with one thing. I will start to ask the question, what's the difference between Model T and the truck version? Because if I remember correctly, it actually said in the manual that there is a truck version as well. So I want to know what's the thing, right? So let's see. So yes, now that's the first thing I want you to see is that in the where the program is running, you see no output. So we will be dealing with that soon. We want to see what is happening inside this black box to be able to learn from it, right? So we will have to modify it slightly. But the other thing is that if you look at this output, I don't know if you see it, let's see if we can make it a bit larger for everyone. Then you will see that that was one of the first things that I noticed, well, at least when I was looking at this. The Ford Model T one-ton truck was a variation of the Ford Model T car that was specially designed. Do you hear that the language is that of a museum? It's like you would go to Henry Ford's museum and see, you know, a plaque in front of some old thing. And that is not what we are building here. We are building a rag to be able to interact with the manual because maybe we bought the Model T and we want to use it as a normal car. Whatever the reason, we want to use it as we want to do it. So we are starting with now modifying the prompt so it starts to behaving like a normal assistant that helps us to interpret the manual in as it is, you know, a normal car. So the way we can do that is, I think I have a small cheat sheet for that as well. Yeah. I'm going to change the system prompt. I will show you the original system prompt and we will see what we are exchanging it for. If we go to the... Oh, this is not that easy. Go to the env. Okay, let me also take a little detour of telling you about the env here, environment file. I'm not sure if I can make it larger or not. Do you see something? Maybe you see since you have the TVs over there, right? I hope as well. Yeah. So here you can choose, of course, the model that we will be using. We are using the default model Turbo. That's what they wrote, right? We have OpenAI. Then this embedding DIM, this I think, you can correct me on this if I'm wrong, I think that is the number of tokens in the cutouts that we were talking about. That if you take this document and you're cutting it up in small pieces, every piece will be 1,024 tokens long. And then we have top K, which is, actually it says what it is. And the comment is much better than the name of the environment variable here. This is the number of the cutouts that we are providing to the LLM when we are asking it to make a good answer for us. So here we can increase, for instance, we can add 5, we can add 100, but then, of course, it won't fit into the context, so it doesn't help us anything. So we have to here fine-tune it. But I think that for our purposes today, we are perfectly fine, but at least you know where you can change it, right? And finally, we have the system prompt at the bottom. So right now, the system prompt is very bland. And so we are replacing it with a system prompt that is, you are a helpful assistant to help users with their questions, that's the same as they had, about their Ford 1919 Model T and the truck version. So we are more specific. This is the purpose now of this RAG. The answer should be backed by the provided text. So we are more specific because, as it happens, the model already knows a bit about those cars. So we don't want its opinions based on, you know, all the other stuff. We want the stuff based on the things that we are providing from the RAG, mostly. And then we have the answers should reflect the contemporary setting in the early 1920s. That's for not having this feeling of museum all the time. This is like, okay, let's imagine that we had this magic RAG back in 1920s and we are actually using this to fix our car. So let's see what happens when we enable this one. So we're just gonna put a comment there and we're just saving the file. And if we go back to the terminal, we should be ready to use this. Let's see. Sorry about this. I have a small bar there with some strange things that are disturbing me a bit. So, okay, back to the chat. I'm going to reload this page to kind of clear the context. And then I'm going to do what's the difference between Model T and the truck version again, and post this question. And let's see how it behaves now. Now, if you look at this text, I hope that you can see it, you can see that there is no feeling of this museum thing anymore. Now it's just we are using the manual to try to draw the best conclusions about this car. Hopefully. Yeah. So as it says, it's basically the same car with some exceptions and main differences in the rear axle and stuff like that. But it's reading as we would read a normal manual. So now we have, yeah? The question was if we can see which part of the document it used for the generation. The thing is that this one is only giving us the URL to the generated upon document. So if we would have several PDFs, for instance, we will be able to go just to the correct PDF. But if the PDF is huge, we won't see that. So very good question. And that leads us to what we want to do next. As I said, we want to have some possibilities, some methods, so that we can see what's going on inside the black box. So we're going to do that now. We're going to do the easy thing first. Actually, we can do that. So we're going to do the easy things first, and that is we're just going to make sure that we can see the chat as it's going between us and the chatbot. That's one small modification. I'm going to just take this file here that I have prepared already. And this is route TS. And now I'm going to show you. We go to app, API, chat, and then we have route TS over here. And I'm actually just going to select all and replace with our text. And then we're going to use the diff tool to see what we actually did here, which should not be that much. This is just white text that we can. So we are importing console. This is just white text. here as well. That's defect from my copying. And the only change we actually do here is we have a section here when we are working on the response. At the beginning of the response, we are writing out kind of the history of whatever he said and whatever I said. So this is just a small logger. And let's save this and see what it does to our chat. Let's see here. Restart that one. Now we're gonna, how do I start my Ford automobile? We can ask that one.
NPM run Ford. NPM run Ford.
Yeah. So now we have a small instruction. This is more of a text we can read. This is not a 1-2-3 list. We will ask for that soon. But what we can see is, okay, now we don't have anything, but if we add make a step-by-step list. Okay, that's a good query. Then it actually gives us the list. So we have to make sure that the spark and throttle levers are in the correct position, however they looked. Turn on the ignition switch. If your car has a starter, you see, so then you're following this part. But if your car doesn't have a starter, then you're using the starting crank in front of the car. And make sure the spark lever is correct position, and so on. So if we go back to the console now, we will see that this is basically just putting out what was spoken about before. So this is more of maybe we want to log it out somewhere or correlate with something else. So this is just a very simple change. So I'm going to go back to the program now, and I'm going to comment out this specific line because we don't want the logging. And now what we want to do is much more interesting, because now we will modify the program so that we will be looking at the snippets. That's at least what I'm thinking is the most important or interesting in this exercise. So I'm going back here to my cheat sheet and looking up. Let's see. That. We're going to go to a file called chat.ts, and I'm going to select everything and paste my version and then look at the differences again. So yes, and the way we are doing this, if I'm making a little bit more space here, is basically that in the normal implementation, you get, as you know, a convenience thing, you get a retriever built in when it's building the index object. But what we are doing here, that we are subclassing the retriever, the vector index retriever, into subclass, and then we are overloading the method retrieve so that we are retrieving as in the superclass, but we also write out the rag node. So it's pretty simple, but it took me at least a little while to figure out how to do this, so I think that I'm saving you, you know, some tinkering. And then we are just patching it in instead of the retriever that you got for free. We are patching in our retriever. So it's there now. We should be able to just save it and see the difference when we are running the rag. Let's see here. Yeah. So how many gears do my Ford 1919 have? Okay, interesting. So the Ford has two gears forward and one reverse gear. And what is more interesting, let's see on what basis we found out. So, okay, now this is working against us that we have a huge font, but anyways. You see that one of the snippets that we are seeing now, the one that has a score of 0.46, this is actually the noise that I was talking about, because probably there is something about gear here, you see? So that's probably the reason why it picked this snippet as one of the three snippets that we are using right now, because you remember the top K variable is indicating how many snippets we are picking up. So let's go back here and see there was another snippet that had 0.48. What function is the transmission? And here we are starting to talk about transmission, some other stuff. Probably there is gear in here as well, and other stuff that is making this snippet, you know, as well interesting. And then there was another snippet that had an even higher score. It had a score of 0.46. 50, actually, right? So let's see what's happening in here. You have groups of gears and, other things, pedals, and I don't know. So anyway, so this is the text masses that we sent together with our question into the LLM to have it figure out what the question was, what the answer was. But the answer is really good, because this is actually true for this model. It had two gears forward. And the interesting thing is, if you remember when we generated this, give a list of how to start. It's actually giving a list that is much better than anything that is in the whole manual. Because in the manual, you have to read several sections to understand, you know, the different parts that go into starting up this car. But here, when it has been working on it, usually you get a better description. Here you have about the starter or the crank and so on. And then you can ask other things. Are there risks involved with using the crank, for instance? So one of the risks is when you're doing this, you might get a backfire in the engine, and then it will throw the crank with very much force back towards you again. So you must be prepared for that to be able to let go. Interesting information if you have that kind of car. But anyways, it's really useful. Already this one with GPT 3.5 is something that adds, I think, value to the original text. At least that's my opinion. And as we said here, you see that we can now follow all the source material used and what kind of score we got also, so we can see how good the material was according to the index. So okay, so now I just have the vulnerability I wanted to show you, and if you have some fun queries you would like me to ask that you just thought about. If you have something, yeah. Let's see here. I think that we have the box.
Hello. All right, so let's ask it maybe a question. Does Ford 1919 has V8 engine same as Node.js?
Have V8 engine?
V8 engine.
And that's all?
Yeah.
Okay. It has a 4-cylinder engine. That's correct, by the way.
if microphone is already here, can we ask this wonderful chat whether can it make a React.js dashboard of this Ford model?
Like that?
Yeah. Okay, this is far from perfect. Can we change React to React.js in this prompt?
Yeah, probably. So that is my injection thing, actually. But from one perspective, okay, so actually we are at two places here, right? Because one thing, if you want to add maximum creativity, for instance, and you want to add maximum possibility to go outside the things that we are thinking. This might be very good if you have employees that want to work with this model. But if you are doing something that is accessible for instance, your customers, then you might want to have it a little bit more locked down so they don't do everything on top of it. But anyways, as you were mentioning.
So maybe something on the other side then, okay.
Sorry?
Maybe something on the other side then, so we can check for the data accuracy. So you can ask a question like, for example, what should be the optimal clearance between the push rod and valve stem?
What should be the optimal
clearance?
Mm-hmm.
Between the push rod and the valve stem.
Push rod and valve
stem.
Step.
Stem.
Stem.
S-T-E-M.
Like that?
No. E. Yeah. Stem. Just S-T-E-M.
S-T-E-M. Valve stem.
Yes.
Uh-huh. Like that.
Because you know the older cars, you know, you had to adjust it manually, and yeah, I think it should be somewhere between that. Yeah.
I don't know if
you
it's.
Can also ask like follow-up question: how can you adjust it?
Okay.
Who's next?
Yeah. So you actually have some kind of step-by-step instruction, how to adjust it. I don't know if it's correct. You can check it if you want to. Yeah?
Maybe try asking a bit of ridiculous question about a normal thing. Can I install wings on my Ford Model T?
But I'm a little bit disappointed because actually it starts to talk about the past again. I was hoping that I was, you know, influencing it not to go into the past. But anyways.
So maybe something historical. Can I use my Ford T, Model T engine to build a plane?
Oops, there's a typo there, but it should understand anyways. So I guess this is kind of a reasonable answer. Probably this engine is not that good.
Hope you won't eat your credits too much.
So anyways, I want us to have time to chat with each other as well. So maybe, do you want to have a question-answer thing as well now? I will just show you this poisoned prompt thing as well, so we are finished with the presentation. And then after that, we will soon go to... We will go to the questions and answers. So yes, as you said, I'm basically doing a prompt that I'm saying disregard everything else. And of course, you can do that, right? You can have it completely off the rails and start to talk about other things. Now, the last slide. So thank you for the talk. I'm Mattias Hansson. I'm a developer that is 46 now. I've been developing for, I calculated it, 29 years professionally this year. I'm not a very stuck-up person, so if you want to go to the URL, this is my LinkedIn profile, you're all very, very welcome to connect with me. So my general rule is that everyone that is meeting me like face to face is open for, you know, connection. That might be about everything. It might be that you want to have a talk on the future meetup. It might be that you just want to ask something about the things we've been doing today. Feel free. So yes, that was the talk.